they're doing well. I know I have allergy issues, so I apologize in advance for that. Last week, we started on the topic of compassion, focusing mostly on self-compassion and a short meditation to take yourself into a third party to listen to how you speak to yourself as the critiquer, the receiver, and an observer. We're going to continue on to that train of thought with this little mindfulness block. So to start, we're going to start with a short little quote that I found about compassion. In our state of perpetual busyness, we're constantly measured by how efficient and active we are. What is immeasurable is the impact and the value of the slower, often invisible acts of compassion that connect us. Every act of compassion creates a ripple effect that expands beyond ourselves to being large and small. So, wonderful. A big thing that we focused on last week was self-compassion, and we are going to continue on that. First, though, Dr. Neff is a researcher, and she has broken down the idea of self-compassion into three different components. The first is self-kindness versus self-judgment. So self-compassion requires you to see yourself as a imperfect person and respond to yourself with kindness in face of failure, feelings of inadequacy, or even suffering. Self-compassion urges you to accept things will not always come the way that you want, and they can't always be or get exactly what you want, and that's okay. So self-compassion is self-kindness versus self-judgment. Another component is common humanity versus isolation. Whenever you feel challenged, a person usually does feel a sense of isolation, that you're the only one experiencing this hurt, making mistakes, or feeling pain. But your vulnerability and fragility is what makes you human. And recognizing that helps you to connect with the larger human experience. Having compassion for yourself means that you honor and accept your humanness. Last, the third component is mindfulness over identification. This element is all about how you seek equanimity through your emotions. Like so many aspects of your life, self-compassion is all about balance. You shouldn't avoid or deny your negative feelings, but to receive them without judgment. Time, you should not be mindful. You should be mindful to not get caught up in them. So know that you're feeling bad.
Acknowledge it.
But then
try your best to move on. Try not to settle.
So here's a little mindfulness meditation exercise for practicing self-compassion. I want you to close your eyes. Want to close your eyes, otherwise just find a soft spot to stare at. Get comfortable. If you're seated, get comfortable in your seat. If you're laying down, get comfortable laying down. And from here, I want you to reflect on how you would treat a close friend when they're suffering and apply that to yourself. Often we're quicker to accept and forgive a friend for their flaws and mistakes than we are our own. So step one, reflect on your life in the moment. What are your challenges? What are your weaknesses? And what are your biggest pain points? I am going to give you 1 minute to think on this. I am going to step off camera to blow my nose just a moment. Yeah. more seconds here. What are your challenges and weaknesses? And what are your biggest pain points? Wonderful. Now, step two of this exercise. Imagine how you would respond if a close friend was feeling and experiencing those exact same things that you just identified. What would you say? How would you feel as if they confided in you? And what words of encouragement or comfort would you give them? And regardless, some people don't like imagining having a conversation for this step too. Some people instead like to imagine a letter. So if it helps you in your mind, start, dear friend. I would suggest starting like that. And just like before, I'll give you 1 minute here to work on this. What would you say to a friend who is experiencing those things? Bringing you a quote from Mother Teresa. If we have no peace, it is because we have forgotten that we belong to each other. So moving on, we're going to focus on the topic of a quiet ego. So when we have a quiet but not silent ego, we're able to do a better job of listening to others as well as the self, to approach life more humanely and compassionately. So there is some research done by Dr. Waymond and Dr. Bauer, and it's called the Quiet Ego Scale. It helps us to assess our tendencies and our behaviors, and the more statements that you find you agree to, the more likely it is that you are satisfied and balanced with your life in not being defensive, if you're being flexible and you have inclusive worldviews. But the spectrum can also identify places where you might want to develop a little bit more and try to live a little bit more compassionately. So this is self-reflection for you. I'm going to read some statements and you just need to think that I have a good handle on that statement, or I can really work on that statement. And it can be both. You can have a good handle on something and still try to be better. There is nothing wrong with that. So, we'll start with the statements. Just listen and think to yourself, I have a handle on that, or, and or, attention when I am doing things. Statement, I feel a connection to all living things. I don't do jobs and tasks automatically. I am aware of what I'm doing. I don't rush through activities without being really attentive to them. I feel a connection with strangers. I feel a connection to people of other races. criticizing somebody, I try to imagine how I would feel if I were in their place. When I'm upset at someone, I usually try to put myself in his or her shoes for a while. I try to look at everybody's side of an agreement or disagreement before I make a decision. Another person's point of view. For me, my life has been a continuous process of learning, changing, and growth. I think it's important to have new experiences that challenge how I think about myself and the world. I have the sense that I have developed as a person over time. Once more, just a little faster. And remember, just think, I can work on that, or I have a handle on that. I pay attention. I'm connected to living things. I am aware, not automatic. I don't rush. Strangers. I connect with other races of people. I can imagine if I was in someone's place when offering criticism. If I'm upset with somebody, I put myself in their shoes. I look at both sides of a disagreement. Another point of view. I have continually learned, changed, and grown. I crave new experience that challenges how I think. I believe I have developed as a person over time. Right or wrong about that list. Just some self-reflection on where you are in your little compassionate journey. I'm going to end this with two quotes. The first is from the Dalai Lama. If you want others to be happy, practice compassion. If you want to be happy, practice compassion. The last quote here is going to be from Gil von Stahl. Better than 1,000 meaningless statements is one meaningful word, which, having been heard, can bring peace. So that was today's little exercise on compassion,
bringing mindfulness
and a little bit of meditation, self-reflection. Remember that you can do this anywhere. Meditation isn't for old, boring people that live in the middle of a mountain. It's everywhere. Being mindful, bringing awareness to yourself.
And with that, I just want to say this is Francis once more, and it was a pleasure having you. So thankful that you were here for this little